And I wish to follow in the footsteps of the explorer Shackleton. So the second trip, I went to Falkland Islands and to South Georgia. But as I said, I'm going to give you a little bit of history. As Julie very kindly said, that the Geographic Society has been interested in going down to the Antarctic, and they encouraged that way in the 1800s. No one owns the Antarctic. It was a place that was discovered, you know, maybe in the early 1700s by Cook. The first footprint probably was a sealer in the 1800s, but by everybody was excited about this continent, even though it was isolated, yes, and it had an unbelievable weather and fascinating wildlife. And people would also often ask me, why do you want to go down there? It takes so long to get there. It's just cold, ice, and snow. So after today, I hope you'll know why I enjoy going. To go back to the treaty, they decided it would be for promoting science, and they would have it for peaceful purposes only. There would be no drilling, no mining, no military, and no nuclear. And they exchanged the science experiments. The Russians have actually drilled through the 2 miles of ice to get some fresh water that's millions of years old, and they've shared it with all the other scientists working down there. There are now presently 70 different research stations and representing 30 countries, and they are, you can see all over. And the United States has 3. They have one at the peninsula, the Palmer Station, one at the South Pole, the Scott Amundsen, and then at McMurdo, which we'll visit later, at the Ross Sea. And you can see by the map that there's Australia and Japan, Argentina, France, all different people who have research stations down there. And I have to tell you that the Antarctic doubles in size in the wintertime. The sun sets in March and doesn't rise to September. There's usually 4 months of the year when you can go down there. And as you can see, it's surrounded by ice. And you can see the west side and the east side, and there's the mountains in between. And I should also tell you that when you go down there, you have to be prepared for the weather. It's a long, long way down there. And let's start. We'll fly from O'Hare down to the tip of South America, Ushuaia. And of course, Ushuaia to me was a little Swiss village with a beautiful national park. And it's interesting, when I first went down there in 1999, there was 20,000. The population today is 60,000. My students would ask me, are you going to stay at the Holiday Inn? But there are no indigenous people down there. And this is the only continent, it's an international continent without war. So we will be staying on this ship. And I'm going to give you the size of the ship because we're going to compare it to some other ones later on. This ship, the Clipper Adventurer, is 333 feet long. It is 53 feet wide. And also, I would like you to notice the bridge, the windows. Notice how high it is from the deck or the dock or the water, because we will have waves that come over that. This is the inside of the bridge. You're welcome at the bridge at any time. The crew is willing to tell you and eager to tell you how fast they're going, where they're going, what direction they're going, how deep the water is, how cold it is. And so, as I say, we still have a long way to go. We have to cross the roughest water in the world. It is the confluence of the warm water from the north and the cold from the south. And it churns and churns just like a washing machine with waves of 35 to 40 feet. During the time we're on the ship crossing this in a day and a half, 500 miles in a day and a half, we have lectures on the geography and the history and the wildlife. Once we're on board, we are given instructions where the safety boats are, life rafts and life jackets, and told never to fall off because the water is 28. Though they turn the ship around, they would not. They would fear you would be have hypothermia. Here is the means of travel. Our expedition leaders would go out every morning and decide where we were going to go. Was it going to be a wet landing or a dry landing? We usually took three of these expeditions in the day, morning, afternoon, and evening. And here we are. We're about to go off. And of course, you see we have our life vests on. We would be able to, as we left our ship, we would turn our room number over, and then we'd have to turn it back when we returned. They didn't want to lose anybody. As we enter into the Antarctic, I want you to look at the different environment. People think it's all ice and snow. There's volcanoes down there. And also notice the wildlife. Notice their eyes, their beaks, their feet. This is a little adelie. And of course, the penguins are birds, but they do not fly. They waddle and they toboggan. The reason being is their bones are solid, not hollow like a straw, like a cardinal. And there again, they can toboggan for half a mile, for 50 miles. Here's some volcanic rock. Here's a rock hopper. And of course, this is the largest plant down here. This is the lichen. Now, not only do they have lichen, but they have a lot of meteors. Now, we did not see any, but the scientists are very interested in these because they can study them and find out about our Earth and how it came to be. They can be as the size of a marble or as big as 40 pounds. Thousands and thousands fall on the Earth, but they're easier to see in the Antarctic because of the black and white contrast. There's also evidence of the whaling industry during the early 1900s and late 1800s, and here's the evidence. Now, we were told by our expedition leaders that we could take our pictures and our memory and only leave our footprints, so no souvenirs. We have to leave it there. And of course, these are the boilers that we noticed that use the blubber. They would boil the blubber from the whales to make oil for their lamps and their ships. How many of you would go swimming with me? Oh, I'm sorry, so few of you decided to go. Well, I always feel when you're in Rome, do as the Romans. So I went swimming. We didn't stay in all day, but it was fun going swimming down at the Antarctic. As we cruise around, I want you to notice how big the environment is in the mountains, how tiny our ship is, even at 330 feet, or how the Zodiac is so tiny. And of course, there are 300,000 icebergs down there of all shapes, and sizes. Some as big as Rhode Island, some as little as a bitty burger. The lower left-hand iceberg shows how many times it flips. It keeps flipping, and you can see all the ridges when it's flipping. And then on the right, you see the calving, and we'd hear the moaning and the groaning of the different icebergs, and they would be breaking off. And if you're careful, you can see the penguins catching rides on the different ice floes. These are the glaciers. They really are frozen rivers that are sliding down the mountains. And the blue ice is beautiful. It's the oldest ice of all. It's the ice that has been compressed down for hundreds and hundreds of years, and all the oxygen has been pressed out. And of course, there's lots of birds, not only penguins, but also gulls, sheepbells, and we would see them all as they passed our ship. This is the amazing wandering albatross. He can fly around the world without even stopping. He usually flies 5,000 or 6,000 miles to feed his family. Here's the giant petrel whose wingspan is 7 feet. And of course, there again, we have the penguins. And there are 17 different kinds of penguins, all in the Southern Hemisphere, from the Galapagos down to the Antarctic, only 5 at the Antarctic. And this is a chin strap, and the penguins return to the same rookery every day or every year. They spend most of their time in the water feeding themselves. But when they come ashore to breed, they build them out of the rocks or the nearest. And here you see a rock hopper and a chin strap. And now you see some gentoos, and you can see how they've built up their rocks for their nest. They are monogamous. They come back to the same rookery every year, and they can tell their mate by their call. And they take turns being parents and sitting on the nest. When we're on Brown Buff Island, we noticed that this penguin was just flipping his flippers, and we were concerned because we thought maybe he was hot. That's the way they call themselves. But the poor penguin, his egg had rolled out. We wanted to assist him and put it back, but our ornithologist said we could not. It was not the thing to do. You can see how little the egg is compared to my boot. And of course, you can see the adelie with the little brood patch and his egg. And of course, my first trip, I only had a small camera, so some of these are a little blurry. We were excited when we were going to visit one of the research stations. We were going to visit the British station, Port LaCroix. And of course, our captain said we could walk there because the pack ice was so hard. And you can see the penguins share the station. And of course, at these research stations, they're studying the ozone layer, the green gases, the glaciers, the volcanoes, the penguins, the wildlife. In this particular one, they were studying penguins. And I remember going into this little building and buying my postcard and a stamp to mail it home. This is to show you how we look. We have all sorts of layers, big boots, and also to prove I was there. We're about to embark on a beautiful journey down the Lemaire Channel. There again, notice the beautiful mountains, the reflections, the sky. Here we are, just about to go through the channel, but we can't. The ice is not melted enough. But I think this is a good time to tell you that I can remember one day waking up early before anyone else, and I was on the deck, and I just looked around myself. I saw the blue sky, the blue water, the blue icebergs, turning around 360 degrees and thought, oh my goodness, how insignificant I was. Not in a sad way, but in an awesome way that I was able to be in this beautiful place. And of course, our captain wanted to see how close he could get. And this gives you a perspective on size from adult to the iceberg. And of course, if you're out the Zodiac and can get some ice for the drinks at night, why not? And of course, we'd wander around in expeditions and seeing the glaciers, which are really frozen rivers, sliding down the mountain and breaking off. And one day, we all of a sudden heard this cracking and just this loud booming noise. And it was an avalanche that was coming down the mountain that had started. Fortunately, we were safe. We heard it, saw it, but we were all right. And of course, you visit the different penguin rookeries. And as I say, they come back to the same rookery. Penguins, as far as the eye can see, this is called Penguin Island. And all penguins lay two eggs in hopes that one will survive. The emperor, the largest, is the only one that lays one. And of course, here, these are the dailies. I'm happy to tell you he survived because he ran away. And let me also let you know that a penguin has a lot of wonderful camouflage, black and white, that a school bird, that mean bird that really is looking for a chick or an egg that's fallen out of the nest, he will be looking for them, and he is mean, and he has a wingspan of 4 feet. Now what's happened to this poor little fellow? His mom is going to be mad at him. He's dirty. But you know, they spend 75% of their time in the water feeding. And of course, their mainstay meal is krill, which are small pink shrimp. So when the guana gets on the ground and you are tobogganing, you are going to be pink. And of course, they build their nests out of the rocks and pebbles that are close by. This is the daily with a little white ring around his eye. Here they are sitting on their nest. And of course, you can see their two, the two they usually lay two, and you can see them trying to get on the brood patch, and they almost don't fit. I've always felt that the penguin is so well adapted to his environment. He not only has the solid bones so he can dive, and he has the flipper so he can fly through the water swimming, not flying, but he also has a pocket in the side of his cheek where he can bring curl back to the babies who have down and cannot go into the water. So you can see a mom feeding her baby. And here's a baby that's almost as big as mom. And of course, they can't swim till they have their adult feathers. And of course, here we have a penguin. My students would say, Mrs. Scott, did you ever pet one? And I would assure them I never did, because I was visiting in their environment. I did not in any way want to harm them. So this fellow picked my boot, and I figured I could take his picture. I want you to notice how the feathers, this is another adaption. Within a square inch, they have over 100 overlapping feathers like tiles of a roof to show you to keep them warm. And of course, look at those strong flippers that they can take through the, fly through the water at, you know, 24 miles an hour. And of course, the tail and the feet. We are always told to dress warmly because the weather could change and we might be called back if it did change. And of course, you can see us returning to the ship and looks like our friends are coming with us. You can see the gentoo on the left side on the top calling to his mate, wondering where he is. And of course, returning from a swim on the bottom, and the rock, the chin strap marching along. Of course, we have to travel in the Southern Hemisphere to see some of the other 17 different kinds. These happen to be rock hoppers from Cape Town in South Africa. And there again, they are rock hoppers because they jump 6 to 7 feet out of the water. We're barely able to stand up with the heavy winds and trying to take pictures, and they're jumping out of the water. And of course, you have to notice the different coloring. The beak is red, the feathers are yellow. And besides penguins and birds, there's lots and lots of different seals. There's mink seals, crab eater seals, Weddell seals, leopard seals. And of course, this is an elephant seal. And here's the fur seal, a baby one, lots of baby ones. And here's the mother fur seal. And these are the lazy, sleeping crab eater seals. And of course, the seals and the penguins get along. The only one would be the leopard seal. Now, I also warned you, not only do they come ashore to breed, but also to molt, because their feathers get very worn out in the ice and snow and the water. And of course, this king penguin is so proud of that egg. She's showing it off. Now, what happened to this little fellow? Looks like his underwear showing. But he is a baby chick of a king, and he hasn't gotten his adult feathers yet. But soon he will. Soon he'll have his adult feathers and be able to swim. But right now, not yet. And of course, when they're born, they are still very hungry and they have to be fed by their parents. So here's one chick that's really looking for some meals, and he's never going to give up. He's going to really let his father and his mom know that he's still hungry. So he is going to keep going. Notice the water in the background, how rough it is and how cold it is. And of course, you can find them by the glaciers, Salisbury Plain, king penguins, the tussock grass. They go into the water, they share the shore with the seals. This was an exciting time. As you know, I said that I was fascinated by the explorer Shackleton. And then following in his footsteps, we're on South Georgia Island, and this is the waterfall that I had read that Shackleton and his men had climbed over. Of course, that was the winter time, and this is the summer. And I might add that you do visit in their summertime, anywhere from, you know, November to February. So I'm taking a picture of this beautiful waterfall, decide to turn around to take one more. And all of a sudden I'm picked up off the ground long enough to think, how am I gonna fall? Am I gonna fall on my face, my back, my camera? And then I landed safely, but I had just experienced a catabatic wind that I had read about. A catabatic wind is a wind that comes over at tornado speed across a mountain. Here again, I was going to ask you, would you ever see cows and a penguin together? This was on Falkland Islands. We were visiting one island that was owned by a young couple that was raising cows, soon to raise sheep because they'd be more lucrative. But they had these Magellanic penguins, and these penguins would burrow into the ground. And I thought, if I owned an island, I might have my own penguin. And of course, you can see penguins low, high, wherever you look, there'd be beautiful penguins. And of course, you're going to see many, many icebergs and the blue ice and the oldest ice. And here is a wonderful long iceberg that it took us 25 minutes to pass. And have you ever wondered how much of an iceberg you see? Maybe 12%. I didn't take this one. This was taken on an oil rig and a friend sent it to me. But at night, as the sun sets and you get up in the morning to the moonscape, and then of course, another day, we have to go to Cape Town and again and see our African penguins. This is at Stony Point, and these are the African penguins. They bray like a donkey. They have the spots, the curve, black beak, black feet, and they also have a little pink around their eye, which regulates the heat. And there's the adolescent over there losing their feathers. This was one of my favorite places. This was Boulder's Beach. And there are homes living above this beach, and the residents would spend a lot of time swimming down here till just such a time that there were more penguins than people. So they decided to dedicate it to the African penguins at Boulder Beach. This is the smallest penguin. This is the blue fairy, and he actually is blue, and he was found at the tip of Australia, and he is just very beautiful. Now, he's the smallest one. He's about 2 pounds and 11 inches as opposed to the emperor, who's 4 feet and 90 pounds. And I said, they are well adapted. Can you see those spiny teeth and barbed teeth? Wouldn't that be perfect for straining your krill when you're out in the ocean all the time? And of course, the little fellow on the right is the Galapagos. He seems to be the most skittish. I remember swimming in the Galapagos with the big turtles, and he would be there, but they'd really swim away when they saw us. And of course, I made 2 trips, never thinking I'd go a third time. And by that time, I had seen 15 of the 17 different kinds of penguins, never expecting to see the last 2 because they were only on 2 sub-Antarctic islands. But what did you know? Quark, the travel company Quark, invited me to join them on a Russian icebreaker for a month, not going to the peninsula, but to the other side of the island, to the Ross Sea. And they were going to visit several sub-Antarctic islands. I could see the last 2. Now, how could I miss? It was expensive, but I thought, why not? You know, it doesn't hurt to call. Would you believe 20 months ahead of time, it was full? But they assured me they put me on the list, and they did. March before we were to go in November, I got an email saying, have your money in by Friday. So I thought, why not? I won't buy a car. And I never was disappointed. I am so glad I went. But this time we did not leave from the tip of South America. We left from the South Island of New Zealand. And we went to the Ross Sea. You can see it's on the west side down below. And many people said, well, is the water is rough? It definitely is. You can see that from the tip of South America, and you can also see from the tip of South Island of New Zealand. And we left from Lyttelton, which is south of Christchurch. And Lyttelton is where many of the explorers in the early part of the 20th century left from. And of course, this is going to be our home for the next month, Captain Klavanoff. And it is 435 feet long and 88 feet wide. So it's bigger, has 9 decks. And so this is going to be our home. And with the 9 decks, that's how you get your exercises up and down. You can see the bridge. There again, the windows will be covered with waves and crashing ones. We're saying goodbye to Lyttelton. And on this trip, not only do we have the Zodiacs, but we also have 2 helicopters, which enables us to fly to the dry valleys and to different rookeries. On each of these ships, each of my trips, they would be under 100 people. On the first one, I think there was about 75, and on this one was under 100. And of course, I told you about the rolling and the tossing and the turning of the waves that are 35, 40 feet high. And there's my seatbelt on my bed. I have to tell you, I'm lucky I do not get seasick. But I could roll and rock and roll and fall asleep with the waves. Here again, we're off for an adventure. And I'm excited because this is a snare island and the snare penguins, number 16th for me. Here again, the red beak, the yellow, and the pink feet. Here's another one, isn't he handsome? And of course, we have to see a shag. And of course, we're gonna see the elephant seals. These are the hookers. The young ones, pups, who are always making noise and saying, this is my territory. Also on Campbell Island, we visit the Brada Forest, which is beautiful and old. And of course, if you're looking carefully, you will see the yellow-eyed penguin. They are the shyest, but they came out and saw us. And of course, doesn't that look like Colorado with the daisies? And he's gonna walk for us. And you can hear how the wind is blowing. But he's going, just investigating. And again, there's ice as far as I can see, and it's beautiful. And as I say, so many different kinds of ice, pancake ice, grease ice, polynya. And a polynya is an open area where the ice is thinner, which a ship is always looking for so they can get through it. And here again, we have the frazzle ice, pancake ice, finger ice, and the blue ice ridges, just beautiful. And of course, as far as the eye can see, the icebergs. And here's our ship going into an area. And of course, you probably are wondering what's gonna happen when we get to the end. And of course, if I'm on deck, I could be walking around and doing my exercise because we are always allowed on the deck. But this ship has huge 6 engines. So when we get back, it'll be just like if you were stuck in the snow because you would be able to go back and forth and back and forth and get yourself out, hopefully. And this is exactly what our captain is going to do. And I will show you, he's going to churn his 6 engines to the fullest and make sure that we can get through. And there it is. He's just churning back and forth and getting going. And here again, we have to watch out for the little creatures. Here's the enemy number 2 of the penguin. He's in the water. This is the leopard seal. And he's looking up and down and seeing if he can see any penguins in the water. Hopefully, if he looks up and thinks it's the sun, he won't get him. But if he does, he's very mean also, like the squid, and he will shake a penguin to death. There's another one. This is the Weddell seal by the Weddell Sea, and he is friendly with the penguins. This was a notable experience. This was Franklin Island, and we are going to a beautiful, beautiful emperor rookery. And of course, we are dropped off and are seeing all these beautiful penguins. The emperor penguin, I have to tell you, is the penguin that mates and breeds in the wintertime when it's 128 degrees below zero, winds of 150 miles an hour. They only lay one egg and it's on the mother's feet. And of course, if you saw March of the Penguins, you would remember how they had to march in the, to the middle so that the chick would be able to mature. They only have one, but they can take care of more than one. Look, Mom, no feet. Aren't they beautiful? Notice how they're preening themselves. They have an oil gland, the bottom by their tail, the colors. Here we are. Now, did I tell you that we had to march 3.5 miles to get here through the snow that was up to our knees? But it was well worth it when you see our the scenery. And as the day lengthens and the sun is falling and you can see the icebergs and the penguins. And of course the weather changes and it's time to march back. And of course, as I explained to you earlier, they would always tell us to make sure you have enough clothing extra if we can't come to get you, because both helicopters have to be working in case one of them doesn't work that the other one can. So we're on our way back. And of course we see Mount Erebus, which is the most southerly active volcano. You can see the smoke coming out. And of course, Mount Terror, it's an extension of the Andes and those mountains that divides the continent. Here again, 360 degrees. You can't take it all in. And here's what it's like to live on an icebreaker with no stabilizers. And we're moving up and down among all this beautiful ice as far as the eye can see. And of course, there's creatures skating. And now we're going to have an interesting experience. We're going to visit one of the huts. Now, these huts are owned by the New Zealand Trust. And the first hut we are going to visit is Shackleton's hut from his one of his trips. And his, he said, roads, where we going? We don't need roads. This is Cab Hoyt's for his 1908 trip. And it was interesting, the New Zealand Trust is in charge of these huts. And they had visited them. These huts were 100 years old. And they were thinking, should we destroy them? And then they decided, thankfully, that they would restore them. And in 2005, it was started. And they were very careful. They inventoried every item in this particular hut. There are 40,000 items. And I'm going to show you. You see us standing outside? We can only go in a few at a time. And also before we could go, before we left the ship, we'd always have to vacuum our pockets, our boots, our sleeves to make sure we were not contaminating anything. And of course, here's all the storage. Notice the dog houses. And as I told you, 40,000 individual items they inventoried. And they'd either send some back to New Zealand to be fixed or bring in scientists and conservators to work on the premise. The interesting thing about it, they found under the front stoops two cases of whiskey with only one bottle left. And of course, they took it back to New Zealand and had a connoisseur reconstituted, and the director of the New Zealand Trust was on our ship, and he raffled them off for several thousand dollars. Here's Shackleton kitchen, just as he left it 100 years ago, where his laundry is and the sleeping bags. And of course, he had a dark room, and there it is. And this was his view when he got up in the morning and as he left. And this is what we look like when we are parked in the ice garage. And you can see how tall it is and how long it is. One day, we had an exciting day because our captain said the pack ice would allow us to wander around. We could get off the ship. And they advised us to get off and wander around and to sit on the ground and wait that the penguins, the emperor penguins, would actually come to us. And they did. And I felt so thrilled. It was so worth it. The penguin lady could die and go to heaven. Look at these marching, beautiful. And here again, preening. shining. And of course, we were told that you should not get any closer than 15 feet, but they don't count. They don't understand that. So they put out a flag. So we'd stay on one side and our fellow penguins would be on the other side. Waddle, waddle. And of course, they were in groups. They love to toboggan, as I told you. They will also like to get in the water, so they flop in. And of course, getting out and they swim, getting out's much harder. Now, these are the elegant penguins, the emperors, and they are just, one is more handsome than the other. And this is an egg the ornithologist brought in. We couldn't have, but they did. Now, we are going to somewhere that our ornithologist, who had been to the Antarctic 200 times, had never experienced before. And he was really worried because we were parked in the ice garage, and the ice garage means that, you know, the weather was not good. So we'd be dressing all our layers and taking them off, and finally we're able to go. Now, with about 90 people on the ship, we can't all go at once, so they would divide us in groups. And our group had gone earlier the day before. So this day, we were going at midnight. It's 24 hours of light. Here we are flying over the valleys, the dry valleys. Sorry for that. Sorry for that streak along the window. That was on the outside and I couldn't do anything about it. We're in Taylor Valleys and McMurdo Dry Valleys. And doesn't this look like a moonscape? And of course, it's a place where NASA has done a lot of experiments. The astronauts go there to practice because it's the driest of it. Less than 2 inches of precipitation, which does not melt. And it, of course, this is barren. There is not even much water there. And of course, there was the 1,000-year-old mummified seal. This is one of the saline lakes. This is McMurdo, I told you about in the background. And it runs year-round. And the research stations usually have about 1,000 in the wintertime and maybe 3,000 in the summertime. And of course, you can apply online, but they are pretty strict. You have to make sure you're healthy, don't mind solitude, close quarters, and before you go, you have to have your appendix out. Now we're going to visit Shackleton's hut. Now we're going to Scott's hut. Now, Scott was a Navy man. He'd been there several times, and this is his 1910-1913. And it started to snow when we visited, and so you can see the skis, and we felt that it was very appropriate. He was also a scientist. He was known for his science, and he would be collecting experiments and rocks while he was there. He had a crew table, and this happens to be the officer's table. He had two, and of course the sleeping bags and the kitchen. They left it just as it was 100 years ago, about 100-year-old biscuit. We're about to visit a daily rookery, Camp Bird, and you can see the weather is not too good. We meet up with a few more skuas, and of course, this is evidence of the weather. And of course, there again, we've walked several miles of there, so we're called back to the ship because the weather is changing. And as I'm leaning into the wind, with my ski goggles on, I'm thinking, oh my gosh, I'm going back to a wonderful warm cabin. But what about Shackleton or his men or Scott and his men? And here again, the beauty. And about sunset, we're on there going through the pack of ice as far as the eye can see. And of course, the sun and the waves. Now I'm excited. I'm going to Macquarie Island, and it has 335 days of rain and overcast. But we're going to get to see my 17th penguin. And of course, these are the seals. They also molt like the penguins. Look, Mom, brush my teeth. And of course, they have king penguins. The king penguin is next in size to the emperor. And I was surprised when I saw him. He only came up to about my knee. I thought he'd be a little bigger. But they get along with the gentoos also. Here's number 17 for me, the king, the royal penguin. not the king, but the royal penguin. And of course, they march up and down the beach in groves and many of them. And we have to watch out for them because they don't watch out for us. They would knock us over if we didn't move out of their way. And of course, there again, you can see the environment, the black sand, the volcanic, and you can see the big seal just lumbering on there and being very comfortable being with the penguins and such. So, but there again, it's a windy, overcast day. And soon we're going to visit the rookery of the royals. And of course, it gets pretty crowded and pretty noisy. And soon you're going to see a few fighting. And of course, they get mighty dirty. And if you look closely, this royal penguin really is excited about the baby underneath. He's all clean. Penguins, as far as the eye can see, swimming. Remember, I promised you those 45-foot waves. There they go. Sunset. Now I'd like to introduce you to a few heroes of exploration down the Antarctic. Here are two men in 1911 that raced to the South Pole. You have Roald Amundsen, a Norwegian on the left, and the Navy man, Robert Falcon Scott, on the right. Now, they had different ideas of how to get to the South Pole. Amundsen decided he was going to take dogs and sleds and skis. Now, Scott didn't like to ski, so he decided if I take ponies, I'll go faster. He would take the motorized vehicles. The problem is the ponies began to fall into the snow to their stomachs. And once the mechanical vehicle broke down, they couldn't fix it because it was too cold. So Amundsen won. He got there in December. And Scott didn't get there till the January. And by that time, for 78 days, they had been sledding and sludging and stumbling and just, were out of food, not feeling well. And then when they saw the Norwegian flag, they felt very badly. But there again, their flag was there, and they decided to go back, and they're very cold, very tired. And within 7 miles of the depot, the white owl comes and there's a big blizzard. So they are reduced to their tent and they perish. And this is Scott's final entry into his diary. We shall stick it out to the end, but we are getting weaker, of course, and the end cannot be far. It just seems a pity, but I do not think I can write more. He also included that told the people back at home to take care of his men because they were such good explorers and had been so loyal to him. But it was interesting, these bodies that had died in, the men who had died in January, their bodies were found the following October, and also 53 pounds of experiments and rocks and such that Scott and his men had collected. Now here's our next man. You've met him before. This is Shackleton. And he had been there several times before, but he decided that he wanted to go on him, go himself. And he was, the pole had been, people had discovered the pole. So he was gonna walk across. and such. So he had to get some men. Men wanted for hazardous journey, small wages, bit of cold, long months of complete darkness, constant danger, safe return to Alpha, honor and recognition in case of success. And of course, would you believe he had 5,000 different applicants, even three women. He did not take them, but he did take these people. They were mechanics, plumbers, electricians, explorers, scientists, doctors, and he's in the middle in white shirt, and there he is. He was known as the boss to his men. And I have to tell you about a few important gentlemen that were being important in this story. Frank Wild, with the pipe on the left, he is second command and very dependable. Tom Crean is a sailor on the right, and he was the tough sailor that everybody wanted to be with. And of course, Hurley is a young Australian who took all these pictures. And Worsley, the captain of the Endurance ship. Now, here he is, and I want to remind you that these people do not have satellites, GPSs, walkie-talkies, cell phones. This captain is dealing with a sextant, which is measuring the horizon with the sun. And if you have bad weather, that's not good. Or the chronometer that can tell you about the latitude or longitude. So he was very calm. They also had a stowaway, Purse Blackborough. And of course, when he was discovered, invited to Shackleton's cabin, Shackleton said, you know what? If we run out of food, we eat our stowaways first. So luckily he became a good sailor and he was fine. Well, they started out in England in 1914 in August. And of course their ship was loaded with camping equipment and dogs and food for the dogs and coal and compasses and instruments. And they decided to stop at Stromness Bay in South Georgia to get some more supplies, some more penguin meat, more for the dogs, and more coal for the ship. And while they were there, Frank Hurley, the photographer, decided to climb up to the mountain. Now you have to realize he does not have a cell phone or a small camera. He has a pretty big one that might weigh 50 or 60 pounds. Remember these mountains, we're going to refer to them later. And of course, Shackleton had to get a ship together, he had to get money together to make this possible. And he had this special boat, the Endurance, built out of wood so that it would give and take in the pressure of the ice and snow. And this ship was only 140 feet long. So we're talking small compared to the other ones. The boss, as Shackleton was called by his men, was very, very good with his men. He understood the troublemakers. He kept them busy with music and poetry and theater and cards and such. So in fact, if one of them needed more food, he would share his. So the whaling station says, you know what, men, I think you better get going. The ice is not melting like it usually does. You don't want to get into trouble. So they start off. Remember, they left in August, it's now January. And this is the first day that they've run into enough sun to get off the boat and walk the dogs. And of course, this is their environment that they're dealing with. And here's how they get around. I would like to read for you a diary from Shackleton while they're living on conditions like this. We were camped on a piece of ice floe. An hour before midnight, I felt uneasy. I don't know why. I left my tent and walked across the floe. Suddenly, the ice cracked under my feet. It cracked right under the man's tent. And as the ice opened up, the canvas of the tent began stretching apart. I could hear muffled shouts as the men woke. The crack widened. I threw myself down on the edge. In the black water, a whitish object was floating. It was a sleeping bag with a man inside. I grabbed it, heaved it, and got him in the bag up on the ice. Second later, the edges of the ice crunched together with tremendous force. Then the crack opened again. Some of us were on one piece of rocking floe. The rest were on the other side. There was no more sleep that night. We managed to scramble to a flat piece of ice and huddled together, watching for cracks. Killer whales hunted in the water between the ice floes. The night was very dark with flurries of snow. Around 3 a.m., we lit the blubber stove and everyone had a hot drink. Then we all began to feel better. So this is what it's like when you're living on the ice and snow. And one day, they weren't making much progress and they were beginning to be stuck in the snow. And so it seemed sunny and they could see an opening ahead. So they decided to put up the sails and really do the engine full power and see if they could get anywhere. And of course, you know, working all day, they barely made any progress. Now, as Shackleton says, difficulties are just things to overcome after all. So he's decided to look around and decide, there he is on the deck, the photographer's taking pictures, and he's realizing how awful this really is. Every day when they get up, there's 3 or 4 inches of ice caked on the riggings in the mast. And soon the ship is crushed in the ice and snow, and he has to say, abandon ship. Now, when he abandons ship, he has the men take the things that they have to take with them. And he says, once the ship, you know, ice gets you, the ice keeps you. So he decides if he's going to get his men back, and he's responsible for 27 men, that they would take the lifeboats and sledge them along. These lifeboats are about 23 feet long. So they weigh tons when they're loaded and they're pulling it. And it's interesting, these pictures were taken by Frank Hurley out of a book called Endurance by Carolyn Alexander. So if you want a good, interesting, exciting adventure story, do read it. But anyway, they loaded things on and Frank Hurley had to break half of his glass plates. He could only take half with him. So they keep pulling and they're on the ice for over 497 days. And they're floating on this ice. That's why I read to you from his diary. And they are headed for Elephant Island, which is a very small island. But they finally arrive at the island and they're very thankful to be there. And so they pull the boats ashore and they have their first drink of hot, something hot. And of course, they've been on their way over almost 2 years. They're, I presume, dead. No satellites, no walkie-talkies, no cell phones, no way of communication and such. So there again, Shackleton's thinking, if I have to get my men back, I have to get back to the whaling station. So I want to show you from the map, leaving from England, getting to the whaling station, then getting impacted in ice, and then pulling these lifeboats for 300 miles over the ice. Shackleton tells the carpenter to raise the gunwales and put on some canvas so that 3 can be below and 3 above. So he decides to set out with 5 other men. He takes Frank Wild. No, he leaves Frank Wild back with the 22 men in charge. And he takes Tom Crean and a cook and Frank Wild's up. Sorry about that. The captain with him. And so they are set off and here they are leaving. And of course, the men that are left back at the Elephant Island are waving goodbye as the little 23-foot Cade is on into the ocean. Now you have to realize they don't know when he'll be back, if he'll be back, or when and how he will be back. And of course, these 6 men in this little boat are going to cross over 800 miles of open water with only very little supplies and those very primitive instruments. Now, the other men that are left behind with a Captain Wild, they set up the lifeboats as their housing and make it home out of it. And every morning, Frank Wild says, "Boys, we have to get busy. The boss may be back today." So they each have their chore to either collect something for the fire or to cook or to clean, and everybody is busy. I'd like to show you what the Elephant Island looks like today. When we visited, the wind was blowing, and you can see it's very, very craggy. The penguins are barely able to stay on the rocks. I don't see how they could keep 26 men, 22 men there. And of course, this is what they would see every morning. And of course, finally, the six have landed on South Georgia. But the problem is, they are on the wrong side of the island. They have to cross a mountains of 6,000 to 7,000 feet. They leave three behind that aren't feeling very well on the shore. And Shackleton and Wild and Crean decide that they are going to climb over the mountain. People today have tried to duplicate that sail across the 800 miles of open water and cross this mountain, and they still aren't sure how Shackleton did it. So they are ready. They put nails in the bottom of their shoes from the ship. They take 50 feet of rope and a little stove to melt ice, and they start out over the mountains. And all of a sudden, after 23 hours, they hear some voices down below, and they know that's the whaling station, and they're so excited. So they actually slide down and get there. And of course, when the children see these men, they're really scared and they run away. And remember the mountains I told you about? They had to climb these mountains. So of course, they get to the station. Shackleton knocks on the door of the whaling station, and the whaling master says, "Who is it?" And Shackleton says, "It is I." And of course, the whaling master is just amazed. He thinks he's hearing a ghost because they were presumed dead. But he is happy to help. He sends the Yelko out once, had to come back because of the weather. He sends the ship Yelko out again, and he still has to bring it back because of the weather. Finally, on the third try, they actually rescue the men of August of 1960. And the men are so delighted. But to review with you the timeline of the Endurance, leaving in August, coming back not till 1960, the men were rescued. And then when they got back to England, the First World War was beginning. And many of these men, even after all these hardships, went into the service to serve their country. And I also want you to notice the drift on the ice was 300 miles, 497 days. So these are the men. And of course, Shackleton's motto was endurance we conquer. Shackleton went back again. He was a young man when he died the last time there. And his wife felt he was the happiest there, so they buried him there. So after this adventure, I certainly hope that tongue and pen fail in attempting to describe this magical place. And I hope you agree with Ernest and I that it is a magical place. I want you to keep traveling, keep learning, and when we can travel again, it's been fun to be with you. And thank you so much, and I'd be happy to answer any questions you might have, if possible. So thank you very much.
Thank you so much, June. That was fantastic. And we do have some questions right here. Excuse me. Okay. As I said, we do have a few questions here, but I want to invite anybody else who still has questions to just go down to the Q&A button at the bottom. But we'll start with the ones that we have for right now. The first
question. You know what, Julie, can you hear this? This is sort of a summary. I forgot to show you this.
Oh, go ahead.
Welcome back.
Thank you so much, June.
You're welcome.
So our first question is, do the males and females look the same?
Yes, it's very hard to tell them apart. Even scientists have a hard time.
Another one we have here is, how warm was the water when you went swimming?
You know what? I don't know what the temperature was. It wasn't 28 degrees because there were little, you know, pockets of warm water, but you didn't stay in very long.
Are the penguins afraid of people? I know you mentioned you had to stay about 15 feet away, but...
You know what? They're very curious. And of course, they don't know 15 feet. So we got a lot closer than that. And it's interesting. They are just curious. So they come up to you and peck your boot and your camera. And now we don't interact with them in any way because, as I said, you know, we're in their environment, but they got very close to us and they aren't frightened to us. And of course, the explorers would eat the penguins to survive. But we were not going to in any way harm them, so they were fine.
I think this is just a compliment to your pictures, but did you ever take a photography class?
You know what? Not a serious one. I did take one with my daughter, and we would wander around with a gentleman, but never, you know, a professional one. I just, you know, take a lot of pictures.
How many hours per day did you spend on land visiting the wildlife?
You know, we would go out in the morning and afternoon and evening, and each outing, depending on how far we went, you know, if we were flying for 20 minutes, then we would get a couple hours, you know, in a particular setting. It could be, at the dry valley, so we'd have a walk and have one of our expedition leaders explaining everything to us. Now, if we were at a penguin rookery, we were asked to just, you know, wander, and they'd give us 2 or 3 hours and tell us we had to be back on the ship. So you could wander on your own and take your own pictures. So usually I'd say 2 to 3 hours at least. And especially if you had to walk the 3.5 miles to Franklin, to the Emperor Rookery, you know, it took us a while to get there.
Yeah.
Do you want my video to start?
I think we have maybe 2 or 3 more questions. But then after that, that would be great. When you are out in the middle of the ice, was it quiet or noisy in general?
No, you know what? That's a thing I didn't mention, but, you know, there was no noise pollution down there. It was very quiet, and especially if you're on deck. The most noise is, you know, crunching through the ice, or, you know, when you're on a penguin rookery, they're, of course, making their calling and sounds, but, you know, it was not noisy and such. Not so very peaceful.
Here's a fun one. Do different types of penguins tend to have different kinds of personalities?
That isn't interesting. You know what? In the sense that, like, the yellow-eyed and the Galapagos are very skittish and more shy, whereas the emperor and the rockhoppers and the adelies and chinstraps were more curious and they would come up to us. But Galapagos and the blue fairy would sort of wander around and not come up to us.
We also have a few more questions rolling in as answers, but this one is from someone you know. It says, well, I think probably your daughter. Good job, Mom. Remember to tell them it smelled. Does that bring up anything?
Well, you know what? Thank you, Bonnie. It's interesting. We were told to put mentholatum in our nose, and I brought some along, but it did not bother me. I guess in some places it was worse than others. It was never a problem with me. And it's interesting. I'd like to have a shout out. Some of my students from third grade and their families are watching, I think, if they could get on and register. And, you know, every January I'd have a penguin party. So they were excited to see this. So thank you for allowing me to share it, because they're from California to North Carolina.
Awesome. And do you have a favorite penguin?
Oh, yes, definitely. You know, my favorite is the emperor, not only because he's the biggest, not 90 pounds and 4 feet, but what I am intrigued is by his story. And if you've seen the movie March of the Penguins, you know the story where the couple have to march to the center of the continent because it doubles in size and they don't want it to melt with their chicks are maturing. So they march for 70 miles and then the female lays the egg after several weeks and months and then lays it on the father's feet because it can't be on the ice. And he huddles with the other one for 3.5 months, not eating. He loses a third of his weight. And they cuddle and they huddle around a circle and they go from in or out to stay warm. But as he say, he starts at 90 pounds and then it's 60 pounds by the time the chick is hatched. But by that time, mom has come back and she has food and he can go eat. So I think I admire his lifestyle and his perseverance and endurance to be able to raise a chick in 150-mile-hour winds in 128 degrees below zero weather.
Yeah. Wow. So we have one last question here, but it's not our last comment. We have many comments thanking you for an outstanding and exciting presentation, and a special shout out from Morley, who used to be your second grade student. But our last question is, how fast can penguins swim?
Now, penguins can go about 24 miles an hour. They can also hold their breath for 3 or 4 minutes and such because they dive.
Very cool. Okay. Well, if you don't have any more information to share with us, that concludes our travelogue for today. Thank you so much to everyone for attending and for supporting the work of the Geographic Society of Chicago. For more information on future travelogues or on how to become a member of the GSC, please visit our website at www.geographicsociety.org, and we hope to see you again soon. Thank you so much, June.
Thank you very much, Julie, and thanks to Day and everybody else. It was fun. I hope we can visit again.
Thank you.